Good afternoon, everybody. We are very, very pleased to have everybody here. And we are going to go ahead and get started because we've got a great program and a great guest speaker today. I'm going to do just a quick kind of give you an overview and a context of you know, how we got to all be sitting in this room here today. Yasmin Menayar, who is one of the Hillman students, is then going to introduce our speaker, who is going to talk to you all about social marketing, which I think is a fantastic topic. So I'm sure that there's a lot of interest about learning how the state of the art in that regard. Accenture and Montgomery College have been partners since for almost 6 years. Longer than I have been part of the Hillman program, and so it goes way back. The things that we have done, in addition to having a seminar series here for students at Montgomery College, we also have done work with, we had a Veterans Day event that we did last year to help veterans. We also have been part of the Day of Service. Every year, Accenture has a Day of Service event where people, employees from the company come together, and they've invited us to be part of that. This year, I believe it was on Veterans Day, It was last Friday, and in the past it's been on Martin Luther King Day, so we've been able to be part of that as well. We have a group of people who represent both Accenture and Montgomery College, and we have regular meetings where we plan events like this and look for topics and opportunities that we think that you all would be interested in and benefit from. So we're really happy about that. The last thing that I'll say that I just didn't say before is that Accenture is really a resource in our very own backyard. So it is a multinational organization, does government contracts, does a lot of, you're pointing over here?
Oh, no.
Okay. and we actually have kind of graduated students who have gone on to work for Accenture. I can point to some of those I know in the Hillman program, and I'm sure in other programs and that we have here. So it's you know, kind of pay attention. You're gonna learn a lot today, and I'm glad you all are here. Thank you. And I'm going to introduce now Yasmin Menayar, who is going to introduce our speaker. So thanks very much.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Professor Razavi, for that introduction, and thank you all for joining us today. So today I have the pleasure of introducing Marni Puente, who will be discussing the landscaping of digital marketing with all of us. Ms. Puente serves as the Public Service Marketing and Communications Senior Manager at Accenture. She leads marketing for the firm's state, provincial, and local businesses. She oversees all cross-public communication services, programs, and communications within North America. She is innovative and dynamic marketing and communications leader with extensive experience. Using her experience, she has a passion for shaping and managing frontline communication strategies across diverse industries in both the public and private sector. These sectors consistently increase revenue and heighten customer and citizen engagement. Marni commands a full spectrum of integrated communication processes and builds targeted, cost-effective campaigns in tune with marketing trends and business needs. With over 10 years of work for global consulting firms, she brings a total of 17 years of marketing and communications experience. Marni holds a bachelor's from the Johns Hopkins University and a master's in communication management from Towson University. When not working, she loves spending time with her two young boys, and she also enjoys fitness, nutrition, education, and the arts. So please join me in welcoming Marni Puente.
Thank you so much for that introduction. I actually have another one to add to that list. So two boys and a puppy as of this week, which I'm wondering, what did I get myself into? It's adorable. But anyway, thank you. It's great to be here. I love mentoring and education. I also work on some other volunteer programs with other universities. And it's such a great opportunity for me to give back because I've been very, very fortunate in my career of 17 or so years and the education that I've received in marketing. And it's just something I'm very passionate about. As she said, I've been in marketing about 17 years. I've been at Accenture 2 years, so not all that long. But I have a pretty vast experience in business-to-government marketing, which in the D.C. area, the joke is that you work for government or you work in the government. And I started out in federal government and have been in the private sector for about 10 years now, working for some large consulting firms. And absolutely love Accenture, love the partnership that's in place, and really want to focus today on digital marketing. So while I consider myself to be a marketing strategist at heart, and that's really what my education and background is overall marketing strategy, you can't do marketing strategy in this day and age without digital. And just to give you an example, I was thinking on my drive over here about how the industry has changed in the 17 years that I've been in it. I remember as an intern, I was a public relations intern at the Kennedy Center 17, 18 years ago, and we had just learned to send emails with attachments. All right, now that to you guys is just gonna sound so antiquated. I grew up in high school, I had a word processor, and I remember in marketing in the early days having to go to the printer to see what we called a blue line, right? Before the brochure got printed, you actually had to go to the printer. So it has changed so much thanks to the evolution of technology. It's enabled so much. And I think, you know, I'll talk a little bit about the importance of digital marketing, but you can't run a business, quite honestly, reach your customers, your key constituents, without looking at digital marketing. It is that important, and it's just growing exponentially. I have, as she mentioned, two kids, and my six-year-old is obsessed with his iPad and better at it than I am. And so I think about right now, right, in marketing we do a lot of what we call marketing segmentation, where we look at different audiences, and looking at the generation that's coming up, my 2 and 6 year old, and where they'll be and the technology they'll be using, it's just amazing. It's evolving so quickly. One of the great things about being at Accenture is we're at the forefront of that. So I do have, with my marketing strategy and tactics, those great tools at hand. We have a very, very robust digital marketing program incorporating a lot of social, which I'll talk a little bit about today because I think it'll be good for you. You don't have to be a marketer if you're starting a business. I understand it's finance, right? So entrepreneur, understanding how to leverage social media for business to get into the job market, which is something y'all probably be thinking about pretty soon. And so I just can't stress the importance of enough of really understanding digital marketing, the benefits and value it can bring to you if you do it well, okay? So why digital marketing? I've touched on that a little bit. Let me talk about, you know, why it matters and how it should be used. So why digital marketing? As I mentioned, content is king, right? And digital is such a fantastic way to be able to share content. Particularly through social media, which we'll talk about in a minute. But it's important when you think about content, and this is whether you're trying to sell yourself or a business, that you have a really provocative point of view and a compelling story to tell. So that's something to think about. You want to captivate your audience, right? There's so much competition just about any industry you're in, but particularly online. So how do you stand out? It's with that compelling, provocative point of view. Video is crucial to marketing strategy. There are actually more videos uploaded to YouTube daily than there have been on the 3 major broadcasting companies in the last 5 years. That's pretty incredible. Think about that. More videos to YouTube daily than the 3 major broadcasting companies in the last 5 years. So the news industry, since I was an intern, 20 years ago at the Kennedy Center and did public relations, it's changed so much. You know, people don't turn on their TV to watch the news much anymore, right? I mean, you guys probably are in that boat. So it's just changed tremendously. And then people spend 6.5 hours online daily, right? So if you're not reaching them online, you're essentially not reaching them. The way people use digital services is changing. You know, I touched on that, how it's constantly evolving. So that's always important to keep track of. We really live in a multi-screen world. I mean, you guys, I'm sure, all have smartphones, tablets, TVs, et cetera. So there's just so many formats you need to think about when marketing yourself or your business. And your business has to be online, and you have to engage in social media. And I'll talk about what I think are, from a business perspective, the most 2 important social channels, but you have to do it to be seen and to be considered an expert in your field, and when you're job searching too, incredibly important. And then, you know, when you, if you are in a business where you're selling, you have to think about online as a way to get the customers to buy, right? I mean, Amazon is tremendous at this. And have a really strong call to action on your web page. So that's something to be thinking about, too. So I won't bore you with lots of marketing technical jargon, but one of the things that I just think is so important in any marketing strategy I put together, this is, serves as the foundation. It's what we call the marketing life cycle. There's four phases, as you can see. And just to kind of put this in terms, you know, if you're not a marketer, to understand. So awareness. So think about if you're not familiar with the product, right? Or some, it's a new product to the market, or new service, or new business, for that matter. Building the brand. It's all about awareness. And so we as marketers look at what types of awareness building activities, how can we generate that awareness in the market? Online advertising is big, but now it's online, right? So again, you know, this idea of digital is pervasive throughout the entire marketing life cycle. Media relations is a good way of building awareness. Messaging, posting content on a website. And then there's differentiation. So once you've created awareness in the minds of your target audience, how do you differentiate from your competitors? Okay, so that's something we're always thinking about. And really, you want to think of it as owning the conversation. You want to dominate, and you want to understand where the white space is. And you do that with a unique perspective, typically. So, you know, again, I talked about content, but around key industries, key topics, what you want to be known for, and what can you say that's different from what everyone else is saying, okay? So that's really important. And then it's preference. And I would say at Accenture, we focus more on the latter two, which is preference and purchase. So preference is, you know, they already know of you, right? Which most of our clients and prospects do. Then you've differentiated, which is something we work on every day. But then preference. So this is those top kind of decision makers that you want to continually cultivate relationships with. And you do that via, we say CRM, a customer relationship marketing, but email campaigns, targeted LinkedIn advertising. I'm sure you guys, if you have LinkedIn profiles, you get those very targeted ads, right? They always seem to know what, you know, if you have a wedding coming up, or if you're going to school, or what, you know, of reaching you. And customization, right? It's about, and this is how marketing has changed a lot, too. It's not just about that broad brush awareness and trying to reach the masses. It's really those really generating one-to-one interactions. And then finally, purchase. And this is, you know, your, and we have what we call RFPs, request for proposals, in the consulting world. And if you've heard previous speakers, they've probably talked about this. And I work pretty closely with a lot of our capture teams on those. And so that's where I'm looking at not only a specific segment, but I know the people we're trying to reach by name. I know their LinkedIn profile. I want to know everything about them as much as I can. Psychographics, demographics, you know, how they consume information, all of that. So it's very specific. It's tied to a specific opportunity. And it's really about sealing the deal, winning the deal. So it's just really important to understand this marketing life cycle because it really serves as the foundation for everything we do in marketing. So let's talk about social. And who here, is anyone not on social media? Not to, because I imagine, okay, that's okay. Not on social media? That's okay. In fact, a lot of Accenture folks that I work with are not on social media. I will admit, because I am an old-time marketer, I've been in the field for a while, I resisted, and then I just got to the point where I had to, right? I did the same with buying a cell phone. I was like, I'm not going to do that. And then now I'm totally dependent on my cell phone. If you are in business, social media is vital, really, particularly to build a business. And I'll tell you a little bit about why. But it really is the best way to engage, not only now, but think about the future. Think about how social is just growing tremendously. And think about the younger generations and where they're going to be I mean, by the time my, it may not be called social anymore. Who knows what it'll be by the time my two-year-old is in his 20s. So it really does benefit. And out in the job market, too, I think particularly LinkedIn and Twitter, which are our primary business channels, to have those profiles, because it will get you in front of recruiters. If you're trying to build a business, that's how you're going to do it. So it is incredibly important. So as much as I resist it, I'm now, you know, preaching it. It is incredibly important. But there are four, what we call four pillars of professional social engagement, so things you want to be thinking about. One is just kind of the very basic, which is establishing a foundation, building a brand, again, to differentiate yourself in the market. So establish a presence. It's that simple. It really is simple. You know, if you don't have a Twitter account, start one. If you don't have a LinkedIn profile, probably the most important for you guys as you get out into the job market, build one, and I'll give you some tips on how to do that. Target the right contacts to focus relationship building activities. Grow your network. So once you've got your profile up to par, then you want to start reaching out and make sure you're connecting with the right people. It could be recruiters, it could be industry contacts, if there's a particular, depending what your degree is, if there's a particular industry you want to go into. Media, you know, every organization now has a LinkedIn page, and so you'll want to join groups and that sort of thing in your particular industry to learn about them. And it is amazing once you start doing that how much you pick up. And then finally, get sharing. So, you know, as you become familiar with these industry publications and get articles, or maybe you're ambitious and write blogs yourself, it's important to start sharing. And that's what LinkedIn and Twitter in the business world are really, really good for. And then finally, interacting. So we have what we call kind of our top 20 contacts at Accenture. And it's not only me in marketing. I actually have the business now. So some of those guys that were speaking in that video now are part of our social leaders program. So we are using them, our employers, to be a channel and reach out to their social media network. So it's not even just about us in marketing anymore. So the business is actually using it too to build their contact list, build those trusted relationships. Because it's not always easy to get in the door to meet with a client or prospect. But you can use social media oftentimes. Send them an interesting article. Establish yourself as a thought leader. So that's a great way to do that. And then it's not just about a one-time, you know, reach out. It's about continuing to cultivate those relationships once you do. Okay? So I talked about this. Just, again, you know, building your social profile is hugely important. And whether it's Twitter, LinkedIn, or another channel for that matter, just some basic things to remember. You know, make sure it's professional. But show a little personal. Don't be afraid to do that. And I do that by interest. I mean, think about, you know, even the bio she read, you know, that I'm a mom of two and married and have a puppy now. You know, that kind of thing is good. You want to provide a little bit of personal insight, not too much. You know what's appropriate and what is not. But then there are some elements of building your social brand we'll talk about in a minute. But you want it to really be impactful. Grow your network with focus and regular connecting. So again, you know, who are those top contacts that you want to be reaching out to regularly? These could be clients, colleagues, you know, fellow colleagues in the room, students in the room, leaders, particularly if it's an industry you're going into. Look at who the leaders are in that industry. Follow them on Twitter. See what they're saying. Retweet what they're saying. They'll follow you. It's things like that that really start to build your social profile. And then do this regularly, right? It's not a one-time thing. I actually have gotten to where I have to schedule it in my day. That's the only way I'll do it. But it's over a cup of coffee in the morning that I get on LinkedIn and Twitter, and I share and, you know, but that's 10 minutes a day. It really is not a big deal, but it will help you tremendously, particularly as you start looking for jobs. Reinforce your thought leadership. This is really important in my organization, but I would encourage you to, you guys are in an academic setting, you're writing, you're doing some really cool projects, I'm sure. You know, think about what might be appropriate to share on social, because that's going to, when you get out in the job market, that's going to help you tremendously if you've got that on your LinkedIn or your Twitter profile. So be thinking about that. Any cool projects you've worked on, blog about them. That's the kind of stuff that recruiters are really going to look for. And then when you get working for an organization, whether it's building your own business or working on behalf of an organization, it's going to behoove you to do that too, right? Because it's building your brand, but it's building the brand of the company as well. Okay. Trusted relationships, we talked a little bit about this. So when you interact, be human, be authentic. You know, don't try to be someone else. There's only one you. And that's just, it's really important. It seems kind of obvious, but it's amazing how people will say what they think someone wants to hear, but really be yourself, right? So I think that's really important. And then be active, you know, like, share, retweet, join communities, mention people or organizations in your postings. So I want to spend a few, before I go into that though, are there any questions or thoughts? Does this all make sense to you guys? Pretty active on social. Probably much more, it didn't exist when I was your age, quite honestly. So I'm sure you're much more active than I was. So it's just, it's a different, completely different day and age. But I do want to focus on, I'm sure you guys are on many channels, the majority of you, but I want to focus on Twitter and LinkedIn because truly for business, those are the two key ones. Those are the only ones we use in my business at Accenture in public service because our government clients, and you guys are here if you continue, you know, if you work in DC, a lot of it's federal government, they are on LinkedIn and Twitter, not so much the other channels or don't use them for business, so that's why we tend to focus on these two, not to say you can't leverage other social channels. I personally love Twitter, and this was one I, like you had said, or not on social, I resisted it. I was like, this is stupid. I'm a communicator. I, you know, only have so many characters to communicate something. Hated it at first. Now, I was at an event yesterday in Boston, and, you know, the senator was speaking, and I got all these great pictures and quotes, and I love it now because it's easy. You can put out some provocative quotes. Just really cool, you know, share cool content, and it's so easy and it's so fast. And I love that because I have no time, right? And so I'd encourage you, get in there, explore, you know. And if you don't feel comfortable posting, what I love about Twitter too, and I think I probably did this the first 3 months, all I did was retweet or like. You know, I didn't want to post, and now I'm like very actively posting on Twitter. But, you know, so even just starting out, it's baby steps, right? Just get comfortable with the channel. And that goes for Twitter or anything for that matter. And, you know, it's the other thing I love about it, and like I said, I was at this event yesterday, and I posted probably 10 tweets throughout the course. We had a number of speakers, and so I was promoting them. And I think I had like 50 followers within the last 12 hours. You know, just random people, I don't know, just following me just because I was active. So it's amazing how quickly you can build your network. It really does kind of happen overnight as soon as you start to be active and to post. So that's another, that's the reason I love Twitter too. It's just, I find it really easy from that standpoint. So what to think about with Twitter, how to connect. So just across the board, you know, your profile is really important. So full name, bio, links, right? So if you're published, even better, include a link. A personal header photo, we'll talk about that in a minute with LinkedIn. And current profile photo. Follow back people who follow you. So you want, technically, proportionately, you want more followers than follow you. Now don't be concerned if you're just starting and that's not the case. It was for me until now, you know, I've got a lot more followers just because I'm really actively tweeting. But it took a while to get there. Connect with impact. So as I mentioned yesterday, you know, memorable quotes, insights, images. So, and it doesn't have to be just professional. I was in San Francisco for an event 2 weeks ago, and my husband and I were in Sonoma County, and I just got a beautiful picture of Tamales Bay and just tweeted about it. And I got so many people retweeting that. Because it shows, again, it doesn't have to be all business all the time. It really is about showing a little bit of the personal side, too. Be cautious when you do that, you know, in terms of what you're sharing. But, you know, if it's just a really beautiful picture or something, people appreciate that. And then in terms of who to follow, you'll see here, you know, those who follow you, recruiters, right? As you start to get out in the job market, that's really important if a recruiter, that you initiate some of those, colleagues, former colleagues, students, former students. And then you can have what's called kind of your public list and your private list. You know, when you want to post something that goes public, or maybe you just have, like, again, your top 20 contacts and you want to keep those in a private list so you can monitor what they're posting, retweet that out, or just share with that particular group. Don't follow obvious spammers, right? Objectionable content or account, be thinking about that. I know you guys are in college. It lives there. So, you know, think that that's a point I really want to stress. It's important because when you get out in the job market, recruiters are looking. You know, if someone doesn't have a bio or a profile photo, I usually don't follow them back. It kind of says to me they're not really invested in Twitter. I'm not going to follow them back. So those are just some things to be thinking about in terms of who to follow, who not to follow. Here's some best practices, and these are Accenture folks from our, most of them local office, although Jared Daly's in the UK. But what I like about these images is these are great header images, right? They're warm, they're smiling, they're not too stiff. It's a solid background, which is kind of a rule of thumb, not only for Twitter and LinkedIn, but quite honestly, if you're ever getting a professional headshot, you want that solid background, so something to think about. And then you can't really see it too well on here, but they have the background image, which is nice that Twitter allows you to do that. And I know for mine, I have the Washington Monument in the back, so it can be a city that you're from, it can be the industry that you're in or want to go into that's representative of you, but I encourage you to do both, have that profile and that background photo. Bio, include job title and role. Now, if you're not working currently, include a description of your skills and strengths if you're job searching, right? Because that's important. That's the first thing recruiters are going to see. They're going to see your photo, and then they're going to see your description. That's your, like, what is it? People have an 8-second attention span. That's your 8 seconds to sell them right there. And they're not going to read on if that's not really strong at the top, as you see with these guys it is. And then links, include if you have a website, I know many of you may not, but that's okay. You know, or if on Twitter, include your LinkedIn, link to your LinkedIn profile, personal blogs if you have them. So links are also very important. Let's turn gears for a second and talk about LinkedIn. So in addition to Twitter, LinkedIn is a really great business channel. It's also complementary to Twitter. How many of you have a LinkedIn profile? So, hey, that's good. Good. Okay. Because that's something a lot of times people don't think about until they actually do get out into the job market, you know, post-college. So that's good to hear. And I start using it now, right? This is the time to start posting. If you've got a really great paper you wrote or something you know that's appropriate to share, post it on LinkedIn. So it's different from the rest of social media because it's specifically designed for business and professionals. It is really the one channel. Twitter's used a lot for professionals as well, but LinkedIn really is, right? That's how they started. That's kind of their niche. So people, you know, users mainly go to it to showcase job experience, professional thoughts. So it's one of those, if you don't have one now, definitely by the time you graduate, get a LinkedIn profile, because if you're job searching, you want to have one. And just some interesting statistics. So there's 83,588 jobs on LinkedIn, okay? This ranges everything from dog walkers to cybersecurity experts. So everyone's using it to job search. Recruiters are looking. Can't tell you how many recruiters I've had come to me, headhunters, via LinkedIn. Adding a photo to your profile makes you 36 times more likely to receive a message on LinkedIn. What do you think? True, false?
True.
Yes. Yep. And then there are 10 billion LinkedIn endorsements. True, false?
True.
These are easy. They're all true, pretty much. and then users with at least 5 skills listed on their profile received up to 17 times more profile views. That's true as well. But I mean, 17 times by adding a photo, right? So these are just things that easy, low-hanging fruit that you want to think about doing. I'll kind of go through these fairly quickly because there's a lot. If you guys, a lot of you are on LinkedIn, you know there's a lot of sections, right? I would say they're all important, but the most two important, again, it's that 8-second rule, 8-second attention span. think about the top part, which you see here, very similar to Twitter, right? So you want to make sure you have correct contact information. Make sure you've got, you know, the correct email address where you want to be found. If you do have a Twitter, Facebook, blog, website, include those links there. Really important because you don't want to miss out on opportunities if you're job searching. Professional headline. So there are two ways that people tend to use this headline on LinkedIn. Some use current or past job titles, while others that are job searching or maybe in school and don't have a job will use descriptors. So as I mentioned earlier with Twitter, same thing to be thinking about here. It does allow you to use up to 120 characters, so you want to be really kind of strategic and what you say in those descriptors. So use that real estate to explain your main skills, degrees or experience to define you, what you would want a recruiter or an organization to know about you. And then photos, pretty much the same applies here, you know, as I mentioned with Twitter, you know, with the main photo and then the background photo. And make sure it's at high resolution. That's something we talk about a lot in marketing. Make sure it's a clear, you know, that don't just take a photo with your camera and assume the resolution's high enough. So as you get more in the market, it may be worth investing in a professional headshot, you know, depending what you go into. So really important. LinkedIn summary, also important. And I would say this is where people have the most trouble. I know I did, right? Because, you know, you think, oh, just a couple sentences, this is easy. But a lot of recruiters now are using this instead of a resume. So you think about what you would want in a resume, you better have it in your summary, right? Super, super important. And make sure, obviously, it's professional. You can add a little personal in it, but make sure it's professional. And avoid generic phrase, what we call generic phrases, like driven and self-motivated project manager. You know, talk more about impact. Just like my resume is the impact that I had. It's not what I did. You know what I mean? So impact. Keep going. Experience in education. So this is a good one for you guys, right? You're in school. Definitely important. And, you know, many of you maybe haven't been out in the job market, and that's okay. So education is something. Internships are important. Volunteer work, which I'll talk about in a second. But again, be thinking about not just the job itself, but the impact that you had or what you did maybe in school, if volunteer opportunities, if you were, you know, in any clubs, that sort of thing. This is all incredibly important because it's really painting a full picture of who you are, which is what you want recruiters and you want the market to know. So the next one, publications, volunteers, interest. Publications, again, a lot of my, I go back to grad school and my project was like a dissertation. That's a publication, you know. You guys actually have probably with the work you're doing now, some pretty cool things that you could post on LinkedIn. So be thinking about that, what you might want to add. Volunteer. Great. It's interesting when I gave a similar presentation to military spouses on Veterans Day last week. And one of the things I said to them, because a lot of them have not been in the job market for a while, so they're coming at it from a, you know, either a gap in resume or maybe not a lot of work experience. But this is an opportunity to shine, and I would say the same for you guys. So if you have volunteer work, put it here because that can make or break whether you get a job, or if you're working for a company, it can be really important because they can say, you know, Marni, wow, she volunteers for the Humane Society. You know, it's a way of establishing those personal connections and common interest, right? So don't overlook this section. Really, really important. Endorsements and recommendations. This one I laugh at because I feel like every day I've got someone, you know, one of my former colleagues, maybe it's job searching, and can I endorse them? It takes 2 seconds. It's really that easy. So once I learned that, I'm like already, you know, always on it. But I encourage you, particularly as you're getting out into the job market or building your own business, ask for endorsements. Don't be shy. And you know what? If someone endorses you, endorse them back. The great thing about social is it's very reciprocal, right? So when it is similar, when someone follows you, there's with Twitter, there's usually the expectation that you'll follow them back too. But that's how you build your network, and it's really that it's kind of a two-way street. You know, it's not just a push communication, but it's that idea of constant engagement. And so endorsement is one of those too. You want to try, in fact, to get at least your top. So you guys probably know, those of you that are on LinkedIn, that you can prioritize your skills, which you'll want to do as you're coming out of college, right, and looking for jobs. So they're like keywords. So think about it that way. If recruiters are searching for you, you want to make sure that the job you want to find, you've got those keywords in your first five skills. And then you want to ask for endorsements. Ask other students. Ask your teacher. If you don't have former jobs, that's okay. But get them to endorse you for those skills. Super important, because it just reinforces that it's not just you, right? It's that third-party credibility. Groups and interest, important. I really like this, because I think for me, I mean, you see like Harvard Business Review, and these are ones in being in marketing and leadership and business. I think not only interesting for me to learn, right, what's happening in the industry, but to share. And again, it doesn't have to be that I wrote the article. If I share it, people start to go, oh, wow, she's a really good source of information, right? I love the, you know, article she's sharing from HBR. So they'll start to want to follow me or kind of see what I'm up to, because they see me as a good source for content and educational materials. So, and then interest groups too, right? So be thinking about that. And also, I would follow the influencers in the industry you're in. Okay, so if it's in finance, who are those top financial, organizations? I admit my brother's an investment banker, but other than that, I know very little about finance. But, you know, I'm thinking that, you know, Deutsche Bank, UBS, all of those big, I mean, follow them, right? They've all got pages. These companies do. Follow them. It not only shows you're interested, you're going to learn about opportunities. You're going to learn, you know, they publish content, as well as Accenture. Please follow Accenture. But Accenture, too, we publish a lot of content. So it's just a great way, while you're students, to be learning about the market, because you'll be out in it very soon. And so now's the time to really start building your profiles. Okay, I'm going to talk. So now that I've talked about that, any questions about LinkedIn or any thoughts? Have you guys had much experience? I'm curious, how are you using LinkedIn now? Primarily business, personal? Networking? Yeah? Okay. Good. Are you posting like anything you're doing with school or volunteer work? No? Yeah, okay. So we have a star in the room. Awesome. Great. No, that's good to hear. Okay. And have you had any kind of reciprocal like feedback on it, or any early recruiters?
Generally, like the more I like update my profile, the more people view.
Yeah. Yep.
So I've gotten like CEOs that follow me.
All right. So there, you guys heard it, right? That's awesome. And it just shows the importance. It really, crazy important, vital that you be doing that. And now, I wouldn't wait. Don't wait till you graduate. Start now. Because it takes a while to build that. It takes a while to grow your network too, right? So both with Twitter and LinkedIn. If you do nothing else, and I think I finally changed. I had a picture of my boy who's now six. I had his 3-month picture up on Facebook for like 5 years. I'm not a big Facebook person, but Twitter and LinkedIn for my business, absolute must. So even if you just focus in on like, you know, two channels. So really do make sure you spend the time, and now is the time to do it, okay? So let's talk a little bit about, so assume you're on LinkedIn, Twitter, you've got this great profile, right, because you're spending time doing it. How do you grow and establish influence? It's hard to see, sorry about that. So you can do this by consistently connecting. We talked about that. It's not a one-time thing. Schedule time every day. I do it over a cup of coffee. And if it's not every day, a few times a week. Just really schedule time. Make it your homework. Connect with impact, right? It's, you know, share interesting, compelling content. Work the program. It's important that you maintain your presence by continually connecting and sharing. Connect strategically. So you don't have to connect with everyone. Don't boil the ocean. Don't feel like, oh my gosh, you know, I only have, you know, I'm only connected with five people and I only have, you know, five followers on Twitter. No, it's the right people, okay? And that it's incredibly important in my industry because we do, if you go back to that marketing life cycle, driving one-to-one named interactions, I don't care if I'm reaching everyone, I care that I'm reaching the right people. Because that's what matters. That's kind of maximizing the effort, right? And seeing the greatest return on investment. You want to make sure you're reaching those right people. Connect strategically, you know, again, build your top 20 contact list. And work the rules. So this is what I was referring to earlier about maintaining a good ratio, like with Twitter, that you want more followers than people that are, the people that you're following. So it's just kind of a good rule of thumb. And continue to grow your LinkedIn network. Bring social life and humanize your presence. You know, we talked a little bit about this already, but your profile, think personally as well as professionally. And what differentiates you? What's really interesting about you? And this can be a good exercise, particularly whether you're thinking about this, you work for an organization and you're thinking about what the key differentiators are, or you personally, you're looking to personally build your brand. Be thinking about what differentiates you. What is your, you know, your value proposition, right? We talk about that with organizations, but each of us should have a value proposition. What do you want to bring to the job market when you graduate? You know, what do you want people to be know you for? Balance authority versus authenticity. We say find your social voice, and that isn't necessarily overnight. That could take a little time the more you do it. Avoid negativity, and this is a big one, guys, and it's hard. You know, we had an election, and I work for state and local government, right? I could not comment on anything, and meanwhile, my friends are out there commenting. Think about, and maybe it's okay depending on the industry you want to go into, but if you go into highly regulated industries and just, or you think you might want to, or you think you might want to work for government, just be careful about what you post. If you wouldn't say it in a job interview, don't post it online, okay? Certainly on Twitter and LinkedIn. The other channels, a little more flexibility, but you know, think of those as business channels. And then finally, create power interactions. Make it personal. Use their name, right? So I do this if I'm talking to a client or prospect, or if I was on a job interview. Use their name. Make it personal. Add humor when appropriate, right? It shows you're a person, you're real, you know. Encourage real conversations and use strong imagery. And we talked about that earlier. Okay, let's see, how much time do I have? Maybe like 10 more minutes? Okay, I'm gonna just touch on other social platforms. You guys are probably all on these, probably much more than me. So I focus primarily on Twitter and LinkedIn. I said those are the two that I really use. You know, I have a Facebook account, I'm on it some. I did add pictures of the puppy this week. That was my one thing. But these are ones. So in addition to Facebook, you know, there's so many platforms now. Instagram, Snapchat. Do you guys use all these? I'm sure you do. You probably know way more about these than I do. They can work for you, too. So I don't want you to rule these out. But I think when you think about these other channels, particularly Instagram and Snapchat, those aren't necessarily ones you're going to be using for business. But it's important to think about what you do and don't do on them, right? Because going back to recruitment, they're going to be looking at all these social channels. So be really careful, okay? And then a lot of the same principles apply with Twitter and LinkedIn. You know, the basic stuff we talked about, like have good images, you know, provocative, compelling, making sure you say what you want to say at the top of your profile. I think these apply across the board no matter what the channel. You know, tell your story the right way wherever you're social, right? So while not all platforms are best suited for business, recruiters will often look, as I mentioned, for you on social media wherever you are. So you always want to put your best foot forward. And then all social platforms really reflect on you, your life, your core values. So you want to ensure consistency and good judgment across the board, okay? Here's some red flags, particularly for new connections and employers. So we talk about this just given where you guys are. Don't use profanity. I know you're college students. But, you know, think about these things, right? It's it'll stay there, and recruiters are looking at these, okay? Pay attention to spelling and grammar. I, as a communications person, can't stress this enough. If you want to go in, if you would go into marketing and communications, one typo here or there on a post is okay. But, I mean, even when I tweet, which is so informal, I am, like, hyper-conscious about typos and errors because I'm a communications person, right? That reflects on me. So think about that spelling, and I know it's a much shorter informal format, but it's also important. Whether you're in the job market or you have a job and you're tweeting on behalf of your company or you're sharing on LinkedIn, et cetera. Use this as an opportunity to promote voluntary charity work, and especially for you guys, I mean, because maybe you don't have a lot of job experience, but you do have, you know, maybe some good volunteer work, charity work that you've done this is a great opportunity to do that. And I know Accenture being one, we've got a really strong corporate citizen program. Many companies do. If they see that you're a college grad, you have some really great volunteer experience, and you promote it, right? Put it up on your profiles and in your resume. They will likely choose you over another candidate if the skills are the same and, you know, they're impressed by both. I mean, it can really make the difference. So think about that. So political affiliation, particularly for me, right? Try to remain neutral. Again, I know it's a tough time, but just important to say that. Particularly if you're in an industry like me where you're working with or for government. Using Facebook and Instagram to connect. Again, I would not consider myself the expert on Facebook and Instagram, but a couple of kind of rules of thumb. They can be a great research tool. Actually, for that matter, anything can. LinkedIn, Twitter. So when you're looking at the job market and potential companies you may want to work for, recruiters, look at the. If I'm going to go in for a job, you better believe I'm going to have looked at that person's LinkedIn profile and Google them online and find out as much as I can about them. And I've actually been in that situation where I've had a job interview, and right away I knew something about a person we had in common, and it was like that great icebreaker needed. So use it. Now, be tactful when you do. So it can be a great research tool, but avoid, particularly Facebook and Instagram, you know, avoid sending, if you don't know them, those are, as you guys know, more personal channels, so you're not going to reach out to them. It is appropriate, though, to connect professionally with Twitter and LinkedIn. So again, those really look at those two as your kind of professional business channels. Okay, just some final thoughts, and then I will open it up to some questions. So stay visible and active. So once you have your social profiles, and I know right now this may not seem so important, but again, when you get out in the job market, super important, or if you're working for an organization, promote your social profiles. I include mine, you know, follow me on Twitter, follow me on LinkedIn. I include the Accenture Public Service page all in my email signature, in my business card. I mean, think about how it's not just like getting a Twitter handle, right? And even tweet, but promote the fact you have a presence because you want to drive people there. So that's incredibly important. Increase frequency of social sharing and use social channels wisely, as I talked about. But frequency, really important. It's not a one-time thing. Consider creating and promoting content. You guys can do this, right? And you are. I mean, with school, be thinking about what you might be doing, maybe a paper, you know, or a project you've worked on and you have like an executive summary of it, or create one, post it online. If I'm a recruiter and someone did that, is going to set you apart, no question. So think about the stuff you're even doing for school and how you can use that in your profiles. And then tweet and share, right? Build those connections, tweet and share. Sharpen your social. So set and stick to a schedule. You know, again, schedule time every day or a few times a week. Work to individual social goals. Not everyone's at the same place, and that's okay. I was like you a couple years ago. You know, just start doing it. There's no, you know, it. There's no great time. You just do it, and the more you do it, the more you see the benefit, and you grow your network, and it's really amazing. But you got to just start somewhere, okay? Start small. It's fine. Support and interact with friends and contacts, right? You guys will probably rely on each other too, particularly when you get out in the job market. You know, those endorsements are super important. Follow and learn from industry LinkedIn groups. As I mentioned before, don't just look at individual contents, look at groups, look at publications, look at companies, look at all of those things. And then finally, I would say just modify your activity based on how people are interacting and engaging with you. So it's just something in marketing in general we do, and with our social campaigns as well, is, you know, we track them. We just rolled out a new thing. I don't know if you guys have heard of LinkedIn Elevate. Does that sound familiar at all? It's kind of cool. I like to think of it as LinkedIn on steroids, because you can actually, it makes it so easy to share content. So I have curator access to LinkedIn Elevate. I can post something, we can include a tracking, Omniture tracking, and I can know exactly who received it, who opened it. Now, with social media, so LinkedIn Elevate is one of those ways to do it. There's a couple of other tools too. But that's how then we, and this is for a company, right? I mean, you don't have to go to that degree right now, but think, you know, see if it's effective, right? Or if you're job searching, are you getting hits? Are you getting recruiters interested? And if not, look, go back to your profile and see, what can I maybe change? What can I pull out, you know, highlight a little bit? Am I connecting with the right people? Those are the kinds of things to be thinking about. So modify, it's not just a one-time thing. It's very, very fluid. So that's it. Hopefully I didn't talk too long. And are there any questions or thoughts? Yeah.
For a business page, what would be like the platform social media that I should like focus on?
So a business, your own website you mean, and then to promote it or?
I have my own website, but like promoting my business through social media, what would be the best?
So I would definitely say LinkedIn, probably first and foremost. Twitter, probably a second. Can I ask, what is finance or what is?
Landscaping.
Facebook? Okay. I mean, that's where, see, and what I do, again, it's, you know, government, right? So it's primarily LinkedIn and Twitter. I think you can be a little more creative, because landscaping is something, actually, Facebook would be a really good one. You might look at some of the other, what are considered more personal, less professional channels, just given the nature of what you're doing. Right. So it also depends on the industry. But definitely LinkedIn, Twitter, no question. And I would say Facebook. There might be a couple of other channels out there. You know, the other thing to think about, landscaping business, I mean, cool video, right? Like what, you know, not just the kind of boring ad, but think about what differentiates you. You know, again, going back to these marketing kind of techniques, what's the white space? Who do you want to target? Industry, you know, are there groups? I'm sure there probably are. There's a group for everything, right? And in video, you know, show like a before and after picture, right? For landscaping, it lends itself to that. So think about some really fun, creative ways too, once you've identified those channels that you can promote it and keep doing it.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Any other questions? Yeah.
Do you think we should, like, it's safe to copy and paste our bio between the different platforms?
Yeah, that's a great question. And that's something I struggle with too. I talked about like that LinkedIn summary. Yeah. I think that while it's more of a narrative than your resume would be, because, you know, like typically resumes are bulleted and that sort of thing, you want to still make sure you have the elements in there. So I wouldn't do an exact copy and paste. And it also depends. With Twitter, for instance, you don't need the full bio. It's a different type of channel. LinkedIn, though, recruiters are using it like they would a resume. So while it may not be the exact, I wouldn't cut and paste your resume in, I would make sure that everything that's in your resume that you want a recruiter to know about is there in your summary. Okay? So it depends on the channel. But definitely LinkedIn, yes. You need to have all that information in there. Yep. Any other questions? Does this make sense? Helpful, hopefully? Yeah.
Question, how much time do you personally spend on, say, your LinkedIn account, or how much would you might spend more than?
Yeah, and not enough. In fact, I've got, and I'm not even our digital expert. There's a wonderful girl, Lee, who's in South Africa. I work for, you know, global organization, and I swear she never sleeps, and she's always pinging me at, you know, crack of dawn, Marni, here's what you can do. So I have someone looking after me saying, in fact, when I went to California recently, saying, I saw you went to California for business. You should post something personal. So we actually have people who are monitoring Yeah, and trying to help us. But she's always said to me, even if it's 10, 20 minutes a day, and now, mind you, this is my business. I'm in marketing. I mean, you guys could do, if you spend on LinkedIn and Twitter, right, 10, 20 minutes every, like, 2-3 days, that's good. That's great. It's different because I'm doing it for work, and so I'm sharing content. I'm targeting clients. So, but I also spend a lot of time training and helping my internal clients, so some of the managing directors at Accenture that are in our social leaders program, I'm pushing content to them and saying, I want you to push this to your top 20 contacts. And what's been really amazing about that is it's open doors to client meetings. When they've done that, they're like, wow, I could not get a meeting with this commissioner. I sent a really cool piece of content or an interesting piece of data. It opened a door to a conversation. So that's why, you know, you might think, oh, social media, you know. It really, from a business standpoint, is incredibly powerful.
And what would you suggest? I'm not a Twitter person.
Uh-huh.
All I know is like what I see on the news.
I wasn't either. Okay. It's dangerous. Once you start doing it.
Is it true? So what, as a college student, what would you suggest be tweeted? I mean, what kinds of information would you put out there?
So, I mean, you can do, you know, some personal tweeting, but I think if you guys know you're going to be in the job market a year or two, and, you know, look at your, so finance, right? Like I said earlier, I would go to, like, the Economist or some of the, you know, financial, Harvard Business Review, too, from a leadership standpoint, and follow some of those companies, Accenture being one, but, you know, Deloitte, at UBS. My brother, who's an investment banker, has worked for all of them. So, you know, but follow them because they're going to be posting really interesting content. Retweet that, or comment on it, right? Or write a blog. Write about a cool, like, a project you worked on. That's going to be huge when you're out in the job market. Huge. Yeah.
So when you're reposting the tweets, you're pretty much just reposting something that someone else will want to look at, but you're using their popularity. Mm-hmm. To gain audience for your own.
Exactly.
I'm starting out doing a partnership development for American Contracting Corporation, which my friend and I started in January.
Okay.
And we just became SBEMB in DC government. I'm wondering how involved the DC government is in, are they individuals or are they actual organizations? Because we found a niche in small business enterprise. And we have,
so you're trying to get in to reconnect with DC government,
well,
am I right, as a small business?
We've even done our RFQ.
Uh-huh, okay.
But the thing is, it's just a really slow process because we're really young and it's hard to find
uh-huh.
people to talk to
uh-huh.
who are willing to give us an opportunity to commence projects. And, you know,
yeah.
So
yeah.
We're trying to figure out a way, and this has been really helpful for me. I just have never
yeah.
had a need for social media. I used to have it.
Yeah.
But it was more personal, so
yeah.
I just cut it
yeah.
off, so I wasn't.
And you can still do that. I don't mean
yeah.
to say you can't use social for personal.
Yeah.
Just be careful when you do.
So I'm going to start this with a company, but I'm just wondering.
Yeah.
Are there organizations on LinkedIn? Or are they
yes.
individuals that have
DC government has a LinkedIn page. I have a good friend who's a lawyer in the DC government. I, you know, many friends who work. Any government agency has follow them. You probably want to get into like the procurement office, and they will post, as I'm sure you know, like their RFPs, RFQs on their website. So I would follow that. And then you may, as a small business, look at partners, Accenture being one, right? Because we're always looking to partner with small business, you know, depending on what you're going after. But yes, so definitely connect, follow DC government. I mean, they have, and particularly elected officials, they all have Twitter handles. They're, I mean, you guys have seen even just recent, you know, campaign, like presidential campaigns. Obama had an amazing social media campaign. I don't know if you guys remember that, but I mean, so they're all using it. I mean, they see the value, so it's a great way to reach government.
Perfect.
Yeah.
I was going to ask for a business card, but your contact information was on the PowerPoint.
Yep, and I'm going to send it. You'll have it. Yeah. Absolutely. Follow up with me, and I'll try to put you in touch with someone at Accenture, too, who can help with.
And do you also have can I have a copy of your PowerPoint?
Yeah, I think.
Yeah. You'll send it to us, and we'll circulate
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yep.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, and this, by the way, these slides are what I often use for training, so it will be good for you to have, because it's kind of a cheat sheet. And honestly, I use similar when I was training and getting my profiles up to date. This will give you exactly what you need to know, so you can get those in a good place. But just start small. Start with Twitter and LinkedIn. Those are going to be key for you, particularly if you're trying to work with government.
Sure. Thank you.
Yep. Sure. Any other questions? You look like you have a question. Just smiling. I know it's Friday too. It's Friday, so it's my easy day. This is fun, by the way. Thank you. I'd much rather do this.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.